Jaromir Jagr had a couple of goals last night. He's got 742 career goals now, third all time. This is NBC Sports Radio.
From the Kcaa Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Jim Manal. Well, this morning, a clear sky, sunshine today with a high of 84, mainly clear tonight, low 54. Monday's going to be a sunny day, high 88, mainly clear Monday night, low 54. Tuesday, sunny, high again, 88. Wednesday's going to be sunny, high 86. It'll be sunny Thursday, high again, 86. Friday, sunny, high 84. Saturday's going to be a mostly sunny day with temperatures around 80. That's your weather forecast for this hour from Kcaa, 106.5 FM and 1050 AM, the stations that leave no listener behind.
It's time for the Kcaa Community Calendar, brought to you exclusively by Learn for Life, a growing network of public charter schools. The clear mission of Learn for Life is to motivate and mentor students who have dropped out of school and provide them with the personalized education and technical training necessary to advance their lives.
Here's a look at the Kcaa Community Calendar. I'm Di Rice. The San Bernardino County Sheriff's Athletic Federation introduces the Compassion Fitness Campaign. If you're looking to get in shape, look no further. The Sweat Boot Camp is here. Compassion Fitness will run through March 26th. Can't afford a fitness boot camp? I bet you can, because it's free as long as you're willing to donate winter clothing or personal hygiene items upon entry. See, not only will you be doing something great for yourself, you'll be doing something great for the homeless in our community. The Sheriff's Athletic Federation will be partnering with Joe Smith and Sweat. The SAF is a nonprofit organization established in 1984 to promote fitness within the San Bernardino County Sheriff's Department. Sweat boot camps will be held every Saturday until March 26th. Start times are at 9:30 a.m. at Sweat Athletics, located at 4833 Lanier Road in Chino. While you're thinking about it, do it. Sign up. Get in shape. Go to www.sweatathletics.com, sweatathletics.com, and sign up for a boot camp date. I'm Di Rice, and that's the community calendar on Kcaa 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
The Kcaa community calendar is presented exclusively by Learn for Life, a growing network of public charter schools where students can complete their education on a part-time basis. To find a resource center nearest you, call 1-877-360-LEARN or visit Learn for Life online at learn4life.org. Kcaa Loma Linda, your CNBC news station for the Inland Empire.
Gotcha Racing Live, heard only on Kcaa, is your command center for racing news, the hottest interviews, and DIY projects. We are your destination for interviews with racers and fans, on-track interviews, in-shop interviews with engine builders, car restorers. Hear from our correspondents on live track car shows. Gotcha Racing Live. Start your engine and race on over to Kcaa 1050 AM, 106.5 FM every Saturday at our new time, 11 AM. Gotcha Racing Live, where we put you in the driver's seat.
This is Kcaa.
It is Empire Talks Back. I'm Wallace Allen on the case for truth, justice, with the right information to help improve the situation. I hope that you're rocking and rolling and satisfied with the seat that you're in, because this is Black History Month and I brought some history into the room with me. Very, very important people. One of them is my mother. If I had not had her as a mother, I probably would be, I don't know, maybe picking cotton somewhere right now. This lady was the first disc jockey in Joliet, Illinois, first African-American disc jockey. The men were trying to become disc jockeys, but of course they weren't as pretty as my mother. And you know how men in charge are when they decide they want to do something. And so the fact that she's a beautiful woman certainly enticed those guys into thinking that, you know, wow, we need to have a pretty lady around. She probably can't do too much, but we'll have. But this lady, my mother, was the first African-American woman disc jockey in the city of Joliet, Illinois at WJOL Radio. The name of her show was The Blue Rendezvous. She was very, very, very much... Well, you'll get a chance to meet her. As I introduce her to you, I've already broken one rule and told you she's my mother. Usually, I have to say she's my sister. You can obviously tell why. She's a beautiful lady. But she also, in Joliet, Illinois, was in... Come on in, Anthony. Anthony, our mood master, is back with us. You know, last week he was not able to attend. He had some very serious business to take care of. I think he made a couple of $1 million. We'll know how generous he is as we talk to him later. More than likely, though, he's going to come up with some kind of excuse saying he didn't make $1 million. But God is great. We're glad to see you back. Glad to have you here. Thank you, my friend. So not only do we have my mother, Ruth Stevens, we also have with us the young lady whose mother published the first African-American newspaper in the Inland Empire. The Messenger was the name of the paper, and the lady that I'm speaking of is Miss Ellen Turner. She and her family and that group of hardworking people in Fontana, California, which used to be known as Fontucky, when they were coming up because of the prominence of the Klan and other folks who didn't particularly have affection for black folk. That group of folks in Fontana worked very hard to establish not just that newspaper, but they started a Black History Parade. We've got the first, was it the first one? We have the 1965 Queen sitting here with us, so we also have royalty at the table. And we also have royalty's mother at the table in that we have Miss Valerie here, whose daughter is the queen of this year's Fontana Miss Black History. Ellen, what do you call that?
Is the Miss Black Awareness.
Patrick. Miss Black Awareness. Okay, that wasn't hard, was it, Ellen? Was it? Talk to me now.
No.
There you go. Say something else. Tell us something else.
Go on. The Miss Black Awareness pageant started in 1964, and the first queen was crowned in 1965.
And that was?
That was Janice Scott.
Very good. See, that wasn't painful. Miss Turner didn't, you know, she helped produce today's show. She didn't have any idea, she says, that she was going to be on radio. And so now that we have her on and she had promised earlier that she would not be able to speak, she has done so successfully. And how you feel about that?
I'm feeling
historic,
good.
Right?
Yes.
Very good. Okay. Okay. I'd like to get back to Mrs. Stevens and talk to you a little bit about the fact that you left Mississippi.
Yes.
Yes, you were born and raised in Mississippi.
Of course.
And you had some very exciting stories that I heard about the things that you as children would do that demonstrated obedience to your parent, but at the same time, a lot of creativity on your part. And I think that's relevant because as we look at what's going on with our young people today, we find that it's probably a little bit different from what mom and dad thought they were going to be doing at this stage in their lives. But I want to show that there is a continuing theme in what goes on with our children in the sense that we are constantly reflecting the resistance that our parents have shown us against the walls of oppression and suppression that stand between us and success. And for those of us who think or thought that it's just a happenstance that, you know, black folk have some problems in society. But folks, we're in the strongest and probably most wonderful place to be in terms of the United States of America. And as we say that, we also have to acknowledge that there's no other place on the planet that has worked so hard with laws to keep black folk or people of color under a grip of suppression based on the concept of white supremacy. Now, that doesn't feel the way it does for most people. Most people, your daily life doesn't make you feel that. But that's why you need to step back and look at what's going on so that you don't continue to judge our young people who are active who are active out here with the Black Lives Matter movement, who are active out here with the Let's Get Registered to Vote, who are out here chasing down politicians who, in their mind, have as little to do with the establishment as possible, because the establishment still represents the chains of oppression that slavery represented when Black folk were initially brought to America, and despite the fact that we've helped build America and make it as strong and as great as it is, and a place that I don't want to leave, there are still many things that need to be worked on. So one of the things that bring joy in the middle of, I'll call it, the sweet and sour life that African Americans have in America, Mom, you would tell me about going to school, how, first of all, you lived in an economic time. Tell us a little bit about your childhood and how it was, what it was like on the farm with your brothers and sisters and my wonderful grandparents.
Well, first of all, thank you. I can say I just gave an honor to my father and mother called their legacy in October, stating some of the things that we're talking about. The things that they left with us that is so great today. And one of them was like, you know, don't go around trying to market yourself because nobody's buying. You must have something to sell. And things that loved, the like what we're doing, you're speaking of the young boys today, what they're doing. A lot of people say, oh, don't do them, but you have to do them, because if you love one another, if you love your people, you got to have a therefore. And that was one of the things I learned very old, very young. I'm so in love with you, therefore I must do something for you.
You have an interesting story about my grandfather and how he loved you best of all.
I thought he did. I thought he had every right to love me best of all. Mm-hmm.
But the wonderful thing you found out was?
He loved us all the same. And we all thought the same thing. We all thought he loved me best. He died, his mother died when he was no more than 14. They became hobos, six of them, and they made it. He learned to be a great cook, came back, bought land from my mother's father, who owned 800 acres of land. He purchased land from her family because he wanted to be independent. They had 12 of us. So six of the children, the boys, six boys, seven boys, and five girls. And six of them went into service. My mother had no telephone. She could not speak to her boys, like the white women in the neighborhood, because they had bought land from us. So therefore, we had to petition the president in order to get her a telephone. So
you're saying that the neighbors who were white,
yes,
who were, and they were neighbors because they bought land from your father,
your grandfather, great-grandfather, yes,
could get telephone service.
Yes.
But your mother could not.
No. Okay. We had to petition.
It wasn't like you couldn't afford it.
No, it wasn't like we could afford it.
It was a law against you having a telephone.
Oh, that's right.
Isn't that something? Okay.
We paid $300.
So $300.
That's what we, for the telephone service.
$300.
Yes. Yes, that was a lot at the time.
We're looking for some music right now to remind me that there's a break. And if that music were to come on and say it's a break, I'd look up at our engineer and I'd say, yeah, you know what? This conversation is so important. I'm going to pay for this one. Let's skip the break. Good deal. I appreciate that, Joe. Thank you very much. So, you're talking again about
my beginning.
Yes,
you're saying,
yes.
What's my beginning? So this will tell you that I had a very strong beginning. We picked cotton. Everything.
Whose cotton did you pick?
Ours. We were landowners.
Okay.
So we picked our own cotton.
Very good.
And everything we ate was perhaps done, you know. The syrup we had was made on the farm. The sugar, the cornmeal, the flour. All these things were made on our farm.
So you were self-sufficient?
We were self-sufficient people.
Now, an interesting thing, you were telling me that there were times when you guys didn't have money because nobody had money, but you guys were pretty well fed.
We bartered. We bartered. We would give chickens and turkeys and all that for shoes. And the shoes were so ugly, I would just lose mine and let the dogs eat them. And then I could not go to school.
Now, this is my grandparents had some pride, and there were some rules that you guys had, something about how you weren't supposed to slick your hair down.
Oh, no.
How you were supposed to wear your shoes to school, and you leave home looking one way.
Come
now,
back.
Okay, now this though happened years ago, is still what we find children doing today.
Yes.
Your mom and dad wanted you to look a certain way when you left home. Describe a walk to school, if you will.
I will. It's like 5 miles, and we had to pass neighbors' houses. Everybody knew one another. So we passed neighbors' houses, and we would take fruits off the tree. You know, we just did pretty much what we wanted. Nobody, if we did wrong and they caught us, everybody took care of us. It was truly what you call everybody taking care of everyone's children. But we were slicker than they were most of the time.
Where would you leave? Where would you leave things like to put your hair pomade? Where would you leave that? Would you have that at home?
No, we'd leave it in a tree. put it in a tree, the branches of the tree, and then we slick it down. You know, and by the time we come back, we'd have it all roughed up, so that it would not be able to tell too well.
Very good. So, yes. So we find that our children today also realize that. You may not particularly like the way they do things, but they do them differently. Let's if we can, talk about the Black History Parade, the Black History Women's, the Miss Black History in 1965, when you, Miss Janice, were the queen, and how it is today, Miss Valley, when your daughter won. What is the big difference between what you guys did on stage to win? How was it in 1965 for you to make that maneuver? Into the mic, please.
What we did in 1965 was have fundraisers. And I won because I raised the most money for our social club.
Okay.
And I had a princess who was Anna Payne Bauer. I tried to reach her so that she could be here, but I wasn't able to. But back then in 1965, Fontana was quite a racist town. We were not allowed to participate in a lot of things that happened downtown Fontana. So we had to get creative, do a lot of things on our own. But we were allowed as a social club to enter the Fontana Days Parade.
Okay.
And that is the year that I was the queen. The North Fontana Queen.
Very good. So they absorbed the African American Queen into the Fontana Days Parade. Very good. So that was before that was long before we began the Fontana Black History Parade.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. And Miss Valerie, how about now? What was involved with your daughter's winning?
Well, my daughter was in a similar situation. She was nominated to be the Queen for 2015. And she has gone on to college behind this.
Mm-hmm.
So it really helped out a lot with that.
Where is she in school?
In Minnesota.
Very good. Yeah. Very good. Did she try to send home for some sunshine during this last episode, the cold weather up there? Very good. So how do you think that helped her out with her career, the acknowledgement?
I think it helped her self-esteem.
Yes.
You know, because she had to stand up. She went in front of the mayor's committee in Fontana and had to speak, and so it helped a lot with her self-esteem because she's a very introvert person.
Okay, so I understand that this weekend, Miss Ellen, we will be we'll be celebrating with the parade this weekend.
Yes.
And an expo. Would you tell us about that, please?
Our 48th annual Black History Parade and Expo.
48th annual.
Yes, and it will start on Citrus and Summit in Fontana and go south to Sierra Lakes, to Home Depot, where the expo will begin at approximately 12 o'clock to 4.
Okay, and what time does the parade start?
Parade starts at 10.
Parade starts at 10 o'clock at Citrus and Summit.
Yes.
Okay, and there's a nice area for people to gather there and drink their coffee and get started.
As a matter of fact, the area where the expo is where the original Jesse Turner Center.
Oh, very
was,
good. Very good.
And where the parade started. Actually, the parade actually really started in the community. The very first parade went through the, what we call the track,
right.
The community, and it went through the track. So it was a community-based parade.
It was right. It was a parade for the of the community parade, for the community.
Yes.
Yes, and it was that way because you were probably not welcome too much outside of the community.
We could not.
Those were the fun Tucky days.
Yes, those were fun Tucky days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, the very serious situation there. I think there was a lineman for Southern Cal or the telephone company who was shot off of his telephone pole.
Yes.
And that began a we're not going to take it anymore movement in Fontana.
Yes.
And the pretty much the entire Inland Empire got involved in that, and changes were made.
Yes.
And a new beginning for Fontana. And Fontana is probably one of the nicest places to live in the Inland Empire, growing well. And, you know, there's other places. But here in the San Bernardino Valley, it's a beautiful place. And it allows for, what do we have, Rialto, San Bernardino, Colton, Fontana, Rialto, Rancho Cucamonga, all these cities living in the beauty of our San Bernardino Valley. And things are a lot better for us because of the kind of work that you and your family have done.
And now the north end is the more affluent area where
gentrification. I think we have people who would talk about the fact that, you know, you'll have a neighborhood that has been left poor, has been left denied growth, and the people who've been there so long kind of give up and start selling their land, and the next thing you know, they're all gone, and a brand new day starts. Isn't that something?
Well, in Fontana, a lot of people didn't give up and sell their land. The land was actually taken by eminent domain and encouraged that they should sell their property.
Very, very interesting. Sounds like, once again, we're getting ready to talk about the powers of the laws and who they seem to be turned against in times of government need. I don't see very often them attacking the rich people. My father points out that as we look at the hazardous life that some communities live in, as we look at the gas spillage in the community that has money, there was immediate response. When we look at the poor communities where there is the battery spillage extended, that took a lot longer to have something happen. We are observing and looking at what's going to happen in Flint, Michigan, in terms of how fast something will be done. We're getting a lot of lip service, but I understand people are still having to drink bottled water there. So we need to pay attention to some of the things that offer us promise, and the things that make this promise occur generally isn't necessarily just the goodwill of folks around us. It's just hard work involved, very much hard work involved. Ms. Stevens, when you were with you had a record shop in Joliet, Illinois.
Yes.
The record shop, you were in business. Your husband, my father, you guys didn't get jobs, did you? I don't remember my father ever having a job. He was a bricklayer, a contractor. He went out and, as he pointed out to me, it was more important to try to create jobs than to go look for a job.
You made jobs. And the reason that I became a disc jockey, Emmett Till was killed, if you remember, in 1955. Mm-hmm. A 14-year-old boy goes to Mississippi, and he whistles at a white woman. And the next thing we know is that he has been shot in the head, dumped in the Tallahassee River to rot. And when I heard this, you know, God puts something in us. God puts fire in us.
Mm.
We're not realizing it many times, the fire we have. But that day, I was so hot. The fire was so hot in me. The flames, you could feel them. I thought, this cannot take place. And I'm so in love with my people. I'm so in love with this 14-year-old boy I've never met. I go down, we're living in Joliet, Illinois. I go downtown and go to park my car, and a white woman comes around me and takes my place. But when you start to burn, the fire is felt. A policeman came up on the side of me, and I said to him, "You must move her." He felt the fire. He did not argue. No. He said to her, "Move your car." So on that evening, on the second evening, we met at a church, Second Baptist Church, and I never met that many of my people, and that many that the fire, the flames of love, and therefore, that's when I started to use the word therefore. Therefore, we must do something. We must call on the outside, inside forces. We call God and have something done. And it was. And that's when I became an advocate for those that I love. And therefore, when something happened, I acted. They were telling me that around town there were no black young men who could be disc jockeys. And I knew it was a lie. Therefore, my love for my black men, I go to the station and I asked them and told them my desire to be a disc jockey. And they said, "Well, if you can afford the time." I said, "What does it take? You have to sell your own time," I'm told. I said, "No problem." Mm-hmm. So I go out and I sell time to the blacks because of segregation. We had service stations. We had a huge black place like the hotel. We had a hotel. We had a nightclub. These fellows were easy to sell. We
had a dentist.
Because they are in love mm-hmm. with us. Everybody's in love with their people. So it's really, when we see young black men out protesting and all, I don't look at them as, oh, they're out there hating folk. They're out there loving themselves and they're loving our people to the place until they're saying, therefore, I will not take it anymore. Exactly. There's time for change. And I felt this. So I sold the time. I had my station. I played B.B. King. Women came in there with all of their troubles, you know, and all these sad songs, you know, Billie Holiday, and at the time for The Strange Fruit, one of the saddest songs in the world, and all these musicians. So therefore, again, I succeeded. A black man became a disc jockey, and that's what I wanted. So when we're talking about what we don't have, there's a fire that burns, and we can just watch somebody drop a match here on a hot day, and we can watch the flames. There's no difference. If you drop a match in our hearts about our people, the love we feel, you feel the flame immediately, and what do? Therefore, we do something. And following that, I did other things.
That's my mother, Ruth Stevens. This is Empire Talks Back. I'm Wallace Allen. It's Empire Talks Back on the case for truth and justice with the right information to help improve the situation. I'm a little speechless being surrounded by these wonderful women of destiny who've done things that and not finished that have impacted not just their lives but the lives of others. We to understand something about the institutional racism that we are working against, the thing that is keeping America from getting all the way over the hump, the thing that is denying the rest of the citizenry the true prize that comes when you absorb, understand, and appreciate this black love that's available to you. And we do not want to take it home and be alone. This is something we want to share. I'm going to talk to you a little bit. I'm going to use this break to talk about prison labor and the 13th Amendment. I'm going to read you something out of a calendar of all things. Prison labor and the 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment, ratified in 1865, made slavery and involuntary servitude unconstitutional in the United States, except as punishment for crime. At the end of slavery, as the end of slavery left a void in the Southern labor market, the criminal justice system became one of the primary means of continuing the legalized involuntary servitude of African Americans. Initially, states passed discriminatory laws to arrest and imprison large numbers of black people, then leased prisoners to private individuals and corporations in a system of convict leasing that resulted in dangerous conditions, abuse, and death. While states profited, prisoners earned no pay, faced hazardous conditions. Thousands of black people were forced into a brutal system that historians have called worse than slavery. We're talking about the Jim Crow laws, folks. You'll hear people say Jim Crow. Maybe you don't know what that means. But these were the discriminatory laws that came to take advantage of the fact that, you know, you could do just about anything with a black man once you made him a criminal. You could put him in jail. You could deny him every right. You could take everything away from him. And plus, you didn't really have to feed him that well, and you don't really have to house him that well. This is really better than slavery. By the middle of the 20th century, states abandoned convict leasing due to industrial and political pressure and extended slavery through chain gangs and prison farms. The legacy continues to influence the criminal justice system today. A place like Louisiana State Penitentiary called Angola, after the province of enslaved people who worked the same land when it was a plantation. Black Lives Matter is initially fighting that same situation where a black kid is generally a criminal until he proves otherwise. They start off with this, you know, this is what I call our state of emergency, folks. Black children, prenatal care for our young girls is not there to the degree that it should be. Therefore, we have many babies born dead. Men, the ones that are born alive that don't have the right postnatal care, post-birth, if they're living in poverty, there's a chance that they're going to get lead poisoning, not to the degree of Flint, Michigan, but at a slower degree in more places, and that's a problem. They go to school. The young boys are, because if they're aggressive and they are talking the way their parents generally taught them to talk in the house, the school teacher, not being familiar with that, tends to take that as an aggressive thing. And so young black boys start getting referrals at a very early age, referrals to the principal. Well, it used to be that just referral to the principal, but now the police are involved. When you get a referral to the principal, the police get involved and you get a police record. So now we've got young black boys who have the same arguments and growth spurts and things that they're excited about in school. But instead of go to the principal and maybe get a SWAT like I used to get, they get the police report. So now when they get to the little summer league and they're trying to play ball or they're trying to get a job, they got a record. Going to school isn't any fun because they're getting suspensions. So, you know, the little rough part, the defense mechanism that says to people that don't treat me well that I don't really care that much about you anyway, that's a psychological truth. You treat me bad, I'm going to go sour apples on you, say you ain't that cool either. So that makes it hard to get a job. Makes it easy to go to jail, makes it easy to get high blood pressure, so your health is bad. Listen, folks, America is missing out when we ruin the brilliant minds of these young black boys and poor folk in general.
Absolutely.
And we need to start demonstrating some compassion, the kind of compassion that was more common in our households before integration than they apparently are now.
Absolutely.
Before integration, as you describe the segregated situation up north, Joliet, Illinois,
yes,
is not down south.
That's right.
You know, we had to have black hotels, you had your black nightclubs, you had your black dentists, you had, you know, and even today I find that we've got a black Elks and a white Elks and a black American Legion and a black white American Legion. Can you, those both represent the American military retired, but we got one for the black and one for the white. I'm sure that that's not because the black folks stopped the white people from coming in theirs. Oh, yes, ma'am. Miss Valerie has something she'd like to say. Go ahead.
I personally have a son who I explained growing up that the things that you do in school will follow you for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
He learned that after 18. He didn't graduate from high school, but he wanted to go to prom with his girlfriend who still was in high school. And he went and filled out the application. They have you fill out an application after you turn 18. And when he went in there, the principal brought out all his file records from the very first day he was in school, and it opened it up and said, why should we allow you to attend prom?
Hmm.
So I explained to him. He came back to me and said, Mom, everything you ever told me was true. What our parents have to realize, especially your young parents, is that you have to explain to your child that everything that they do as a child follows them through life. So in other words, how you raise your child to
yes,
be
ma'am.
Follows them through life.
That's right.
Everything that they see you do, they're going to do later. Everything. They're going to experiment with everything that they see you experimenting, even the things that you feel they don't see you doing.
Right.
So that falls back on the parents. The schools are going to be the schools, but it's up to the parents to stand up and say, look, you know what? I need you to act right. Like you said, we got swatted in school.
Yeah.
I'm one that got swatted in elementary school.
Yes.
You know, but that's.
I never told my mother when I got swatted at school because I would have got another beating at home.
Me either.
Not a beating, but you know, the idea of giving your child a lot of love means you don't have to do that much when it's time to punish
exactly.
them. If you give them the love, just a little bit of inkling that, you know, I'm upset with you,
right.
means a lot more.
Right.
You know, and I have to relate to the fact that when you are a target, mm-hmm. and you know you are a target, and you have things and people that you love,
mm-hmm.
you don't demonstrate that love to them the way you would if you were not a target.
Yeah,
because as a target, a black man as mm-hmm. a target, and we're going to go back and look at the times, and I've got Jamal Lilly on the phone, and I guess Leonard Evans. I'm sure Jamal would be able to tell us how with the welfare, the trading of giving you access to welfare, mm-hmm. but you got to get your man up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. So that we're not going to have no family up in here.
Right.
You know, we'll extend kindnesses to immigrants and people lost all over the world with help and support.
And
but
families.
We designed an attitude here in America to separate the black family.
Mm-hmm.
We designed an attitude and a function, a law with the HUD to separate black housing from white housing if it had federal money in it. The way the government helped identify that was they used a red line on the map. And redlining is something that we all become familiar with. But
yes.
This discrimination,
yes.
this discrimination, I'm voting. My vote is that it's hurting America. It's
right.
definitely hurting America for America to deny itself the gift
right.
that our children can provide, given just the opportunity to not be a target.
Mm-hmm.
Just stop pointing the gun at us.
I think a lot of it has to do with how they're raised, though.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It has to do with how they're raised. If the parents are installing in their children that you are somebody, that you can do anything that you want to do positively, then, you know, it would change a lot that's going on.
May I just say something when you're talking about your children like that? If a parent makes it very clear, and we use nature a lot.
Mm-hmm.
My parents use nature. I am the tree, and you are my branches.
Correct.
And if you hurt, if the branch is hurt, the tree is hurt.
Mm-hmm.
So don't hurt the tree, because then I may have to cut a branch out.
Right.
So you are I am the soil, and you are my seed.
Mm-hmm.
You heard that subtle. You heard that subtle threat about cutting a branch off.
That's right.
Boy, that means a lot when you're hooked on the tree that you want to be on.
You want to be on.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes.
And
so
you teach them that I am the soil.
Right.
You are my seed.
Right.
And there's going to be a harvest. And you're going to be my harvest. So therefore, my harvest has got to be a good harvest.
Exactly.
And I'm going to take care, the tree is going to take care of the branches, and I'm expecting to harvest something that I can be very proud of.
I can't hear myself.
Right. And I have to agree with you on that.
And my father and my mother had 12. First thing they said, own a home, not a car.
Okay. Exactly.
And we follow the rule.
Right.
But when you're attached to something, and you attach with love, we back to love.
Right.
The forces work with you. You're able to do anything.
Correct.
And I believe, and that's where my father and mother followed the rule. If someone was sick, they fed them.
Mm-hmm.
If someone needed help, they were there. All the rules that the Bible speaks of, doing for your neighbor, they did it.
Right.
And I think that if we were with our children, and I held on to that with mine. He's old as I am, almost. But
I think I'm older.
I had tough love. You have to have love, first of all.
Right.
But tough love is right. The love.
That's how I grew up in a community with Miss Ellen's mother, Miss Jessie, where, you know, I wasn't going to get disciplined by you. Because then you're going to tell my mom, and I'm going to get disciplined by her, too.
That's right.
So, like you said, we used to sneak and do things that we weren't supposed to. But we sure had a lookout. You know, we're going to make sure somebody knew if somebody's parents was around. Right. Or even the older kids.
And that's respect.
Yes.
Now, you could say, well, that's being sneaky. No, that's being respectful. Because right. Children have to grow. And they have to grow outside of that umbrella that the parent is growing.
That's right.
That
exactly.
is but they also have to have deference. They have to be able to follow the rule. They have to be able to appear. Mm-hmm. To be respectful to the limitations while they are looking in every direction and any means to get beyond that border.
Correct.
This is it's like a you know to escape. Mm-hmm. You have to have a plan to escape, right. But you have to look like you're satisfied.
Exactly.
And so this is a very important part of what we're doing. I'd like to ask you, Ms. Stevens, is there anything I've missed at this point? Because I'd like to talk to Mr. Lilly and Mr. Evans and check and see what their contribution is at this point. Is there anything you need to add before we get going? Okay, hold on a second here. Hold on. Mr. Garcia, are you okay?
No, I'm not.
Okay, what do you need, sir?
I need you guys down over here. It was real loud in here.
You need to turn your earphones down.
Yes.
So which one is your earphone?
I have no idea.
Okay, I know you did, but must have had a good morning here. Which one is this?
Okay, did you just turn me down? Now I need to be turned up over there.
Okay. All right, give me a little music for my audience here while we get Mr. Garcia squared away, our mood master. Hang on. Yeah.
He can't do that.
Okay. Empire Talks back. I'm Wallace Allen on the case for truth and justice with the right information to help improve the situation. I'm sorry we can't get the mood master hooked up for you today. I don't know what's wrong with that. You are missing something as usual, though he is the best bass player on the planet as far as I'm concerned. His mother and I agree about that. Sorry right now. Can't get you hooked up.
He needs to turn me up over there on that end.
Well, why don't you go talk to him? Because I don't know what to do. Yeah, well, he's already said that. So
okay. Turn you. Unplug me.
Okay. All right. This is Empire Talks Back. We are dealing at this point with a very important issue. I've got an extremely hypertensive artist that we have to give our attention to. Do you have him hooked up so he can hear? Yeah, plug him up. Okay. All right. Now, play. Anthony, I need to hear you play.
Just a minute, please, just a minute.
do da 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 do da do 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 do. Because you'd rather hear him play than hear me sing. Could I get Jamal up on the line here? Jamal Lilly, is that you?
Yes, sir, Wallace.
Yes, sir. So as you've been listening and paying attention to what we're doing here, what exactly is it that you'd like to add or question you'd like to ask? And how is it that we have not gotten your mother on the radio yet?
You know what? It's funny you mentioned that, Wallace.
I don't think she's laughing. I'm not.
She's listening right now.
Yeah, she's listening, and she's not laughing either. How come I'm not on the radio? Wallace's mother's on the radio. I've got a story to tell, Jamal. So, you know, let's get that straight. I want her to be sure that I'm throwing you under the bus.
All right, man. Well, you know, my mother is a little more, I don't know, modest. Just she doesn't necessarily want to be on the air, but she does love to impart her wisdom.
That's what we're talking about. We're not talking about, you know, getting her on the air to brag. We're getting her on the air to share the important right. program that she came up with that is still important. It's probably not being used enough because she was an educator. And as we're...
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I just had an earful last night. We were going to see the tax man. And we had a long trip there and long trip back and a long appointment. And she was letting me know quite a bit about our family.
Yes.
That's what struck me when you were talking about family. I had just told my mother last night that I'm an anthropologist, sort of an armchair anthropologist. I'm in the process of putting together a family ethnography. And just what you're doing right here, the oral history and chronicling all of these experiences, and relating them to the issues that we're facing today, that's mm-hmm. the purpose for doing that ethnography, because there are a lot of solutions. There are a lot of people walking the earth right now that if we would just take the time to allow them to impart their wisdom, we would be so much further along down the line in solving a lot of these issues that we continually re-tackle generation after generation. And I'm sure your mother can see history repeating itself, and it's got to be somewhat frustrating for her that, you know, we continue to not learn.
Mm.
So that's my my takeaway from all of this is how timely, you know, I say there's no coincidences, but just how timely this is because it's right along the lines of what I was talking about with my own mother, and it's so much of what all of us need at this time. Black History Month is somewhat designed to do that. You know, I was just talking to my own children today about Malcolm X. You know, today's the day he was assassinated. And we're going to see their grandfather because today is the day he was born. He's 84 years old today.
Yeah, see, the idea that our history is so close to us is a beautiful thing and a great way for us to exercise this love connection that we have by talking to our parents and talking to our grandparents and talking to that lady across the street, talking to that person next to you on the bus. You can learn something, and more importantly, you can feel something. You'll end up with a feeling of inclusion and a feeling of self-esteem that you just will not get by, you know, doing your own little mental masturbation stuff. You got to talk to other folks. Get involved, you know. I appreciate that. And now let's see. Mr. Evans on the line. I think he may have something that he wanted to add. Leonard, are you there?
Yes, good morning.
Good morning. God is great. We're grateful.
I would like to say that concerning your mother, people should know...
I'll take that very differently now, you know, than I would have at a younger time when we, you know, used to play the dozens and stuff, you know, but you and my mother have a very special relationship, I'll just have to let you know that I caught a little bit of the old days just in myself for a second when you said, your mother.
My point here is that if people pay attention to the quality of her speaking, her respect for herself, her respect for others, the dignity in her manner of speaking it's just volumes beyond what she says, which is so important, but how she presents herself, not to mention that here is a woman that is a beautiful woman in advanced age, and it's hard to capture in words. Now, what you were talking about earlier about the extension of slavery, there is a book that will tell people everything they want to know about the de facto slavery that went on well past the end of the Civil War. The name of that book is Slavery by Another Name.
Mm-hmm.
And it talks about unconstitutional laws that were part of Jim Crow that weren't struck down until the early 50s that allowed for the incarceration of minorities in general and blacks in particular, and then to be sold to a private corporation to pay off the fine. And this resulted in indentured servitude, people being chained to a post in the middle of a field for noncompliance, extremely brutal conditions. And in terms of parents' role in what's going on with young people today, the parents have a crucial role. You can blame the schools, you can blame the police, you can blame everybody else you want. But the truth is that the parent had the child much longer than the school will have them, something like five or six times as much time with the child. And that's the primary influence. And parents need to understand that they can be friends with anybody. To their children, they need to be parents. And they have two choices. The police will discipline your child, or you discipline your child.
Now, that's a truth that is going to...
I don't think that's a hard choice.
No. That,
you have to accept the responsibility of being a parent and realize there are benefits that will come to you that will last by accepting the responsibilities and the challenges of being a parent. You will become something different and better for yourself, as well as create a much better child that will be an asset to you in later years and an asset to society, because this is the tragedy you're talking about. What we have here is wasted American assets. And people can...
A wasted American asset. We'll have to agree with you on that. That is the that is the point that we're making. That we have an asset that America is turning its back on. As we talk about, you know, some of the children of today and the parents of today, and we do want to give all responsibility to the parent where it belongs. But we also have to still acknowledge the power of government. The power of our government that has now the parent kind of, well, if you spank your child, you can go to jail. That's not the way I was raised. And I tell you, the threat of the spanking was important because you didn't want that. And not that you were getting beat with tree limbs and fire hydrants or even ironing board cords. But being denied the thought of your future love, that's what all of that is about. Our parents of today, the young parents of today, don't have the support that they need. They are being their children are being targeted because the education system is not right. We're top heavy. Our administrators are making all of the money. Our teachers are not making enough. We do need to raise our children
Mr.
as a village.
Allen,
we do need to raise our children as a village. We're not able to take our children and allow just the parent to raise them. The parent has not that ability. The schools have attention. The little cell phones, the whole deal says that we as a society have to work and absorb and work with our children. Mr. Evans has another question. I'm sorry here. Leonard, your question?
Quickly, let me remind you of my father's father, that's my grandfather, talking about his grandfather, who was born in 1829. Trust me, my friend. Don't wait on the government. You don't need the government. We've gotten terrific results without the government.
Well, you know, I agree with you, Leonard. There are certain thinkers and people who are equipped to do that. The one percenters prove that. The fact that we've got a group of white people and some mixed in that are not, a tenth of the 1% who own just about everything. The 1% own most of it. So we know that there are some brilliant people. But the group, the folks, the glue that hold us together, they need support. They need some social adherence. The same way we as a group need highways, the same way as a group we need water, as same way as a group we need our utilities, there is a group need for compassion.
I agree.
Healthcare requires a group approach. I've suggested in the past the idea of single payer may be erroneous, but the idea of a single negotiator to set prices for who pays suggests to me that we really wouldn't have to change anything except get a great negotiator, get the pharmaceutical prices under control, get a standard of pricing for every operation and procedure with the 5 to 10% range for payment to be done by the same people who are paying. Everybody will save money except the pharmaceuticals, which, you know, my goodness, when you're making 200%, you know, I just find it hard to feel sorry for you. And you've got plenty of money for research, you know. So we are in a global economy, which requires a global consideration and does not allow for a bump in the tire that represents all of the money. No, you don't have to wait. You don't have to wait.
We need to take action.
Well, we're gonna go back to our historian people who took action in the past. What we're here celebrating. That's why we're here celebrating the work that they've done, because they took action. And I agree with you, but our time, our history shows that we've always had people who took action. Crispus Attucks took action. He was the first one to shed blood for anything that was going to be called America and in an institutional form. So we've always done that. We've done our share. We built America, but we have not received the benefits, the true benefits of that building. And America has not felt the true benefits of an enthusiastic, participating black population. We're here. But the enthusiasm has got to be, some of it's got to be used to cover our back instead of looking forward. And that's because government has put us there. Yeah, Leonard, you're right. We can't look to government for help because government has been the thing that has held us back. But we can look for government for some regulation and control. Mrs. Stevens.
Yes.
It's been a blessing to spend these short-lived years of my life as your son. You have been an inspiration. You are still an inspiration. I'd like to see if you would continue to work with us on building up our radio program. I understand that, you know, some years ago you had a big beer distributor that was sponsoring your show. We still can't get sponsors
that.
We need your help and support. We cannot afford to let Mr. Stevens hog up all your time like that. Miss Ellen, your commitment, your family's commitment, your mother, Jessie Turner, would be just extremely, I'm sure, happy to see that you're still struggling to carry out the work that she started and began here in the Inland Empire. The history of the Fontana Parade is rich and strong, and you've been there every moment of that history. We want to thank you for your commitment. Miss Janice, as the queen from 1965, may I say that you are still a queen, and the years have done you kindly. You are a very handsome woman, and I'm sure that Lorenzo is waiting carefully outside to be sure that he's here to be sure that you saved the last dance for him. Okay? And we can appreciate that. God bless us. Pop, come say hello before we get out of here. This is my father, Jim Stevens. He's totally supportive, been everything to help West Side Story newspaper and the development of our radio show and things of that sort. Pop, say hello to the audience. Let them know.
Good morning, radio audience.
Good deal. Pop, you're from Texas.
San Antonio,
Texas. So, folks, we've got a rich history here. I'm looking forward to continuing to share that with you, and we'll do that next week under two circumstances. One, if the good Lord's willing. Two, if the creek don't rise. God bless you. Thank you very much for deciding to spend your time with us. We'll be happily here under the blessings of our Lord and Savior next week.
Thanks for the invitation.
To KCAA, Loma Linda, California. The best station in the nation.
We'll be ready to do whatever's asked of me, and if that's to bring along a draft pick and to start until that guy's ready, then I'm willing to do that. If that's to go the full 16, you know, I'm excited about that, doing that. And if that's just to help that guy as he takes over, just whatever my role, whatever's asked of me, I just want to help us win football games.
Sounds easy enough. Let's go to college basketball. Men's play action at halftime right now. Number 6, Maryland, 5 points better than Michigan, 41-36.